Hello and welcome to the last episode of Herbal History. In this episode, we'll cover the opium poppy, the history of its use, and the subsequent derivatives made from opium. We'll start off with the ancient history of opium, followed by the biology of the plants derived from the opium poppy, as well as its chemical constituents, as well as its extraction. Then we'll discuss the various derivatives made after the fact. Let's get started. The earliest known records of the opium poppy, Papaver somniferum, was found in Sumeria and Assyria, making this poppy one of the oldest medicinal plants ever used in recorded history. It's believed that this plant came from Asia Minor, but its exact time of discovery is unknown. The Sumerian Empire that flourished for 1,000 years, between 4,000 BC and 3,000 BC, had tablets that date back to 3000 BC that mention poppies and poppy juice and how to collect it for medicinal purposes. In the ancient Sumerian language, it's called Gilhul or joy plant. The Assyrian Empire that succeeded the Sumerian Empire named this plant Repepal. It is speculated that the Latin word Papaver, which is the genus name for poppies, was derived from that Assyrian name. The Assyrians, like the Sumerians, also collected poppy juice, which was then placed in earthen pots. After the Assyrians and Babylonians were conquered by the Persians inherited that poppy cultivation technique from their preceding empires, and different preparations of opium were created shortly after, in the 6th century BC. Like other Middle Eastern empires, the Egyptians cultivated opium poppies as well. Although the use of opium was generally restricted to priests, magicians, and warriors, they were generally used for communion with different gods. In the mythology of ancient Egypt, Thoth was said to be the inventor of opium, and Ra, the chief god of ancient Egyptian mythology, told the Egyptians how to make a headache remedy from opium. Now to ancient Greece and Rome. The word opium is derived from opion, which means poppy juice in ancient Greek. This plant likely came from Asia Minor to Greece. The ancient Greek people associated this plant with different gods of sleep, which includes Hypnos, god of sleep, Morpheus, god of dreams, Nyx, the goddess of night, and Thanatos, the god of death. Opium is also mentioned by Homer in Greek mythology as an intoxicating, pain-relieving drug used both in the Iliad and the Odyssey. Virgil also mentions this plant in the Aeneid for the same purposes. The ancient Greek regarded opium as a symbol of consolation and oblivion, and crowned all their nocturnal gods, the statues at least, with crowns made from poppies. This was based on the idea that sleep was the best medicine and the most powerful consoler of humanity. Hippocrates frequently touted the benefits of using poppy juice to make opium wine. Opium was also combined with other plants such as hemlock to produce poison to slay the condemned for execution purposes. The Romans inherited this knowledge and culture from the Greeks and continued to use it both for medicine and a poison. It is mentioned by Pliny in 50 AD that Emperor Nero was the most frequent user of said plant for poison purposes. During the time of the Arabian Empire, the Arabs called the opium poppy Abu el-Nom, better known as the father of sleep. During a time when the Arabs ruled Egypt, preparation of opium was commonly and widely spread throughout the Arab Empire. The well-known Arabian physician and philosopher Avicenna, in the 10th century AD, wrote his famous thesis about opium, touting its virtues before dying from opium overdose. As the production of opium flourished in Arabia, it was then exported to Europe and India. These Arab traders brought knowledge of medical uses of opium to China and India, as mentioned before. This happened sometime between the 11th and 13th centuries AD, and at that time it was used mostly by the elite to control dysentery. During the last Ming Empire, which lasted between 1628 and 1644, Sun Chen prohibited the use of tobacco, viewing it as a new world evil. The Chinese people responded by mixing tobacco and opium together and smoking it in special pipes, until eventually they wound up smoking pure opium by the end of the century, and about 25% of the population was on opium. Now we need to circle back for a second and talk about India. Like China, India was using opium thanks to the trade with the Arabs, but it was in use in India for much longer than China, specifically Bengal. However, the Indian state lost its hold on that monopoly in 1757, leaving a power vacuum that the East India Trading Company took over. And so its company sold opium all across India, although it's not allowed to sell to China. Various Indian merchants, however, held auctions to sell opium to smugglers who would then sell to China. And through this process, opium was distributed all throughout China as an illegal drug. A new war on drugs had begun. To that end, the current emperor at the time sent in a new enforcer and wound up destroying 2.6 million pounds of opium that was sold via smugglers on American and British ships, as well as a Hong Kong merchant. This created a new war, of which the British sided with the smugglers. And by 1842, the smugglers won. This led to Hong Kong becoming part of the British Empire, and 21 million pounds were given to the British government. However, this drug trade would not last long, since the British people pressured the British government to end the opium trade. But by this point, the black market had already saturated the area with opium, and it would not stop until after World War II, following Mao's takeover of China. In 1947, the Opium Empire was retaken by the Indian government. Now on to Europe. Opium came into Europe as various potions and mixtures purchased from other parts of the world. Paracelsus, in the late 1400s and early 1500s, popularized the substance as a painkiller, even though it had a high fatality rate, and created a compound known as laudanum, which was a mixture of opium and other compounds. In the 1600s, the famous doctor Thomas Sydenham, known to his folk as the English Hippocrates, popularized laudanum as a means of treating the Black Plague. His pupil, Thomas Dover, created a new medicine called Dover's Powder. This was a mixture of opium, ipecac, and licorice, and saltpeter. Prior to becoming a doctor at the age of 40, he was a pirate and was the inspiration for Robinson Crusoe. Now on to the biology of the opium poppy. The opium poppy is an annual species of poppy that produces flowers that are either white, red, or purple, depending on the cultivar. All parts of the plant produce a white latex compound upon a mild cut. This is where opium comes from. The subspecies nigrum is well known for its purple flowers and gray seeds. This is where the edible seeds of poppy come from. That's where you get the poppy seed bagels and whatnot. Now on to the history of morphine, which is derived from opium. In 1803, the French researcher Derocine isolated a salt of opium. It is unknown what this compound is, but some speculate this compound was morphine. In 1806, the German pharmacist Friedrich Wilhelm Adam Stirner did experiments to try to obtain methotic acid from the opium plant. During the 57 experiments trying to do so, he accidentally obtained an isolation of a compound he called Principium Somniferum. In 1817, he published a paper showcasing his findings, renaming the compound morphine. It was first denied, but a review in later years repeating the experiment showcased that he did, in fact, obtain this compound. During the 1830s, morphine became used as an analgesic and was used extensively during the Franco-Prussian War and the American Civil War. And since hypodermic needles were not readily available at that time, it was taken orally instead, or just dumped on the flesh wound itself. The Union Army bought and used 2.8 million ounces of opium in both tincture, powder, and pill form during the Civil War. And after the Civil War, many of the soldiers were addicted to morphine. It was discovered that you can extract morphine from opium by mixing opium with water and lime. This separates opium into several different compounds, including meconic acid. And the morphine actually separates from the main compound at a higher pH. Now on to the different derivatives of morphine. Since this is not a drug channel, we will not be going into the history of these compounds and their use in illicit substances. We will instead look into how they were discovered and first made. Well, let's get into it. The first derivative of morphine made was called hydromorphine. This compound was made by German scientists in 1926. It was first made by adding hydrogen to morphine via a catalyst to create dihydromorphine and using an oxidation reaction, removing one of the hydrogens. Next, we'll talk about oxymorphine. It was first made by reacting oxycodone with a strong acid like hydrobromic acid. This was done in 1959. Now on to heroin. Heroin was first made in 1874 by Albert White of St. Mary's Hospital Medical School in order to find a non-addictive form of morphine. He did so by boiling morphine in acetic anhydride and was sold as heroin due to its potentially non-addictive form and was sold as a cough syrup called glycoheroin. Unfortunately, he was not successful in creating a non-addictive morphine, as we now know. Now onto apomorphine. This compound was first made by heating morphine in hydrochloric acid at 140 degrees Celsius. It was originally sold as an emetic, although it's not used in that sense anymore. Now onto codeine. Codeine was made in 1833 by combining a methyl group, or CH3, into the morphine chemical structure, and as a result created a less potent form of morphine, and is currently used as a cough syrup. Now onto phenibane. Phenibane is another compound with similar properties to morphine, also found in opium. It's not used medically, but is used to synthesize many other compounds, such as oxycodone and hydrocodone. Now onto the compound papaverine. This compound was first isolated from opium by Dr. Merck in 1848, after the discovery of morphine and codeine. Dr. Goldschmidt and others, later in the 19th century, discovered the chemical structure, and then came up with a way to synthesize this compound because only a small amount was found in the plant itself. This compound is mostly used to this day as a muscle reactant. And the final compound we'll talk about is narcinine. It was found in either 1803 or 1804 by Dr. Darocine, mixed in with messicite acid. It was found to have no pain relief properties, but was a good anti-cough medicine, similar to codeine in properties. Well, that concludes our episode on opium poppy and the herbal history series. Time to put this guy to bed in the arms of Morpheus and begin the series on archaeobotany. Hopefully you enjoy the next series as much as you enjoyed this one. See you again.